Hello, welcome to Spiritual Spectrum. My name is James Terrell, and I'll be your host for the next hour. America was founded on the principle of religious freedom. As such, it remains one of the few nations on the planet today where members of every spiritual group are welcome and free to worship as they see fit. Whether the group is large and well-established or small, containing perhaps as few as a handful. The purpose of Spiritual Spectrum is to explore the newly emerging spiritual trends on the American religious scene today. In each of our past shows, we have featured a single group and focused not so much on their creeds or doctrines or beliefs, but rather on the spiritual experience it has afforded each of its members. On this show, we've invited back representatives from three different groups to help us synthesize our exploration of the spiritual spectrum. I'm going to ask each one of them to introduce themselves and to briefly refresh us about the tradition which they represent. And we'll start with you, Crystalyn.
Hi. My name is Crystalyn Beek, and I'm a student of the Urantia Book. And the Urantia Book is sort of an anthology of cosmology, science, religion, and philosophy, and a restatement of the teachings of Jesus, set in 20th century conceptual framework.
Uh-huh.
That's it.
Well, good. Thank you. And you, Bev.
My name is Bev Noya, and I'm a member of the Theosophical Society. The Theosophical Society is not really a religion. You can't quite call it that. It's more a community of people who, I can say, give each other mutual support in their very diverse religious searches. People have debates. Is theosophy religion? Is it science? Is it philosophy? They never quite finish those debates. There's not a clear answer about that. That's the other thing about theosophists, they never finish debating either. You find diversity of opinions among theosophists. So I want to say from the beginning that the things that I'll be saying tonight can't be seen as the teaching of the Theosophical Society or necessarily the truth as theosophy sees it. It's rather, this is how I, as one theosophist, see things.
Good. Anutima?
Thank you, James. My name is Anutima Das. Anutima actually is a Sanskrit name that means the highest perfection. It's the name of God. Das means servant of. And I'm the president of the local Hare Krishna temple here in Denver, and representing and trying to practice as best I can an ancient tradition from India based on the Vedic literatures, the 5,000-year-old Sanskrit philosophy of India, that teaches that we're all eternally spiritual beings, and the goal of our life is to try to understand that and to love God, and that by doing that we can understand and love each other and live in a much more cooperative spirit here in this world and actually experience a spiritual happiness much higher than we can obtain from any other pursuits in this life.
Good. Thank you each very much. The thought that occurred to me as I look around my life, as I read the papers, and kind of keep my finger on the pulse of what's going on in these very chaotic and perhaps even troubled times, would be to ask each of you to maybe offer some of the things that your own particular path gives you in terms of support and guidance for navigating through these rather difficult waters. So if anyone feels like they want to start, you're free to.
Well, for me, the greatest security or the greatest help is in knowing that God exists and that there is a purpose to life, and that I have within me the resources that I need to live a happy and productive and growthful life in developing the personal relationship with God. And I think that with the current conflicts, to have hope that they're temporary and that they're temporal, that each adversity that I experience is definitely an educational experience that I can use to enhance my spiritual growth, and that the way I approach life very much has to do with the level of happiness that I feel and the contentment and satisfaction, and that those satisfactions primarily come from spiritual a spiritual approach to life. And that the hardships that I experience, or the suffering that I experience, is really just temporary and is really a vehicle for me to use to learn from.
Okay. Good. And if there's more that you want to add to that as we go, I'm sure there will be ample opportunity.
Maybe I could pick up with some of what I was hearing you say, and to say I recognize some of that out of my tradition. As I mentioned, theosophy is not specifically any particular religion. Rather, we tend to draw from all the world religions. And as I listened to you, I thought of things that I have felt free to borrow from the Zen Buddhist tradition, for example, Hindu tradition, Christian tradition. I suspect they probably all have these same insights, but they connect with this business about what to do about the suffering, the sometimes awfulness that the world seems to have. I think in particular of a thing I'd like to quote from Eido Roshi, who was a Zen master, who said something that I come back to very often when I'm depressed or anxious or something. He said, "From before the beginningless beginning until after the endless end, the universe is very good." And when I think that the universe is very good, then whatever it is that I'm so upset about, I figure has got to be part of that goodness. And that's a help. The other that I really have gotten from both a Christian and a Hindu teacher, or two teachers, is simply to have no expectations about things. It's when you have expectations that you have disappointments. It's when you have expectations that what's really there that isn't what you expected is not able to be as good as perhaps it could be, because it's simply not what I expected. I think what I've tried to show there is a way of responding to what you talk about, this great degree of suffering in the world, to say, well, now, careful, what are your expectations doing to breed some of that suffering? And also, it's all right, it's all perfect, which sounds to some people very cavalier, but I think it isn't.
Good. Thanks, Beth.
James, I find Krishna conscious philosophy and the Vedic idea that's presented there and the way I apply it to my life very beneficial, in that the principle is there, again, I touched on earlier, that we as individual beings are spiritual, and we actually have an identity different than this body. I'm not white, I'm not a man, I'm not an American, but I'm actually a spiritual being. And in the line of what Bev was saying, if my expectations are based on thinking that I'm this body, and that if I get enough money, I'll be happy, or if I get ahead in my job, I'll be happy, or if I get ahead in my community, these things will satisfy me, that this is actually misunderstanding, and that I need to get more in touch with the needs of myself as an individual spiritual being, and that I can do that, as explained in our scripture, and I'm trying to apply this in my own life, that by meditating on the names of God, by glorifying the names of God, chanting God's name as we're often seen doing, chanting the Hare Krishna mantra, it's not simply a musical exercise, although that's also there too, but it's actually a process of purifying and awakening ourselves as spiritual beings to our original spiritual nature, which is one of happiness. And the reason we're not experiencing happiness is because we don't know what our actual identity is. And we're, an example is given kind of like a fish out of water. A fish has its own nature, and it's meant to be in the ocean. If you take the fish out of the water, no matter what you provide it in terms of satisfaction and comfort, you can give it a martini, and you can give it a nice, beautiful fish girl, and an umbrella to protect it from the sun, and make so many arrangements. But the fish by nature has to be in the water. So if you take it out, there's problems. But if we actually understand in the same way we ourselves as spiritual means, our happiness has to come from spiritual understanding and awakening. And if we can direct our energies like that, we individually, and I feel that I'm experiencing this, and this is what encourages me in my spiritual practice, is that by getting in touch with my spiritual identity, I'm experiencing a higher type of pleasure, not so much dependent on the ups and downs and topsy-turvy world that we're all experiencing in our day-to-day life.
Well, this is interesting because I hear a certain kind of consensus coming out here that seems to appeal to a rather other dimensional or even afterworldly kind of thought system or view of the way the world exists. If I read you correctly, what you're saying is that, yes, there are problems here in the physical plane, but the answers may not stem from there, and perhaps the problems themselves don't really come from there primarily either. Do you have any sense as to what the responsibility is for the condition of the world today?
Well, I think that we're all individually responsible for our reaction or our response to the world, that we can choose to have a loving, hopeful, and secure outlook. As Bev said, that we really believe that the universe is a friendly place, and that goodness triumphs. But also, you mentioned about the sort of otherworldliness, or that this is not all there is. I think that when you have a sense that you don't have to be in a hurry to accomplish everything that you're driven to do, or that you feel you want to do in a short lifetime, it takes away a lot of the pressure to be anxious or concerned about the condition of the world or the circumstances of your life. And having faith that you really have an eternity to grow and to accomplish really takes a lot of the pressure off, takes a lot of the concern away from the immediate problems that you are faced with.
Okay.
I'd like to follow up on that a little bit about losing the anxiety that goes with being caring about some of the suffering that's in the world. I go back again to this Edo Roshi, the Zen master I heard. He was discussing a thing like that, and he was discussing with a Christian monk at it seemed to be a bit of a debate about how much activism there ought to be to take care of things like starvation in the world and so on. And frankly, they both thought that things ought to be done about that, but they
yes.
had different feelings about it. And I recall Brother David, who was the monk, saying, you know, I'm so anguished over the children who are starving. And I recall Edo Roshi saying, well, I care, but I'm not anguished. And I like that response very much because I think it ties to what you're talking about. It isn't that because we see this grander perspective that there's something more or this isn't all there is. It isn't that because we see that we become uncaring about the suffering that there is. I think we can remain caring and we can do what we can do to try to help people who suffer. But what Edo Roshi was saying was that we don't have to suffer to help them suffer. We can love to help suffer, to help them stop suffering, pardon me. We can love to try to help them stop suffering. A belief in karma, which happens to be one of my beliefs, I imagine many theosophists hold it too,
yes.
Would suggest that the things that happen for a reason. They come out of past actions, past choices. Some people see karma in terms of punishment and reward. I don't. I see it more as learning opportunities, none of them being really punishments, okay? At any rate, some people who believe in karma say, well, that just allows you to say, well, if he's suffering, he deserves to suffer, so do nothing about it. But I come back to a story that I like a lot related to that. It has to do with two people walking along past a lake. They see someone drowning. And the one fellow says, poor fellow, that's his karma. And the other strips off his jacket and says, yes, but it's my karma to save him. So he can still be responsible and yet believe that things don't happen.
Good.
I think if I can make a comment, a significant contribution, and I feel that representing or trying to be a serious practitioner of the Krishna conscious philosophy, is that the suffering, again, that we experience in this world, it's not actually the nature. We're all actually looking for satisfaction. And oftentimes through our political ideas and our economic different philosophies and different sociological perspectives on how we can deal with this particular problem, this particular problem, this particular problem, a lot of people become very much caught up with the idea that through our technological advancement and our increased intellectual capacities that we can somehow devise generally some type of materialistic solution to all these different problems, and that we have to just focus more money here or spend less money in defense as an example and spend more money in this particular project or have more communication and more group discussions and things like that. But I feel a very significant contribution that any spiritual tradition is trying to make to the world is that these are actually the superficial experiences of a root cause. Just like if we have a disease within our body, if there's some poison within the body, we may become conscious of it in the form of a boil or some other type of skin disease. But if we simply try to treat the boil, it may go away temporarily, but the problem's going to come back again, if not in the form of a boil, some other different difficulty. So that we as human beings have a particular ability above and beyond that of animals and lower creatures to understand that we do have a spiritual identity, and that because things aren't lined up in terms of our spiritual needs and the way we're meant to live in this particular lifetime, that there's root causes that can be dealt with that can solve a lot of these different experiences that we're having in terms of economic problems and political conflicts and so many wars and like that. And a lot of this is due to the fact that we don't understand our relationship with the world around us and how we're here very temporarily, and as we discussed before the show and here on the show, that there's actually a higher purpose. If we know what that higher purpose is, we don't get caught up with our conflicts in terms of those lower purposes. It's not that I'm a white person and I have to like struggle with other groups' particular needs, or that I'm American and I'm in conflict automatically with the Russian people, but we're all existing within this planet and ultimately we have the same purposes to fulfill, and there's a unity there. And if we see each other from a spiritual platform beyond this body, which there are seemingly differences in terms of color, race, religion, etc., then we can work together and there isn't so much of a struggle based on competition for limited resources and all the different problems that arise amongst our species and other species as well, between the human and other species. And there's really root problems that we need to address ourselves to, and then everything else is automatically taken care of.
It's interesting. I feel as though you have somehow conspired to deprive me of the opportunity to play devil's advocate and say, well, come on now, what about these people that are really starving, that are really hungry? I think you've all kind of covered your bases real well with that. And my sense is that perhaps when you take a more ultimate sort of approach to the problems that seem so very materialistically based, you've probably all encountered that before. So we, in a way, probably don't really need to belabor that. Perhaps my next question would be, what do you do when a problem comes up for you in your life? If you have children, if there's something that your child isn't learning, if there's something that you're struggling with, say, with an associate in the work setting, how do you approach that in terms of this view of the world that you tender?
I'd say that one way that I try to get some good mileage out of it, never mind the suffering end of it, is to ask myself, what's this for me? You know, I used to say, why is this happening to me? You know, in a sort of, how is the universe so unjust, or how can God be so insensitive that this should happen to good, nice me? Now I tend to say, there must be a reason that this is happening. Sometimes it helps to look for that reason. Sometimes I find it. Sometimes I don't find it, but nonetheless there's some sort of lessening of the pain if I can believe that it really is all for something. I tend now not so much to say, why is this happening to me, but for what is this happening for me?
So that purpose that you feel kind of shapes the whole of life and allows you to participate responsibly can be discovered. If you look?
Well, I don't think I've found it all yet, but I keep trying and I get closer, and now and then I think I have a glimpse of it. About the time I think my glimpse is pretty clear, I find out how partial it is. Then I struggle some more, and that's why perhaps those suffering things you talk about come along to correct my misperception of whatever that ultimate thing is. So I would say, is it something graspable? probably not to me in my current condition, but it's something I can reach toward and I continue to, and I find even the sufferings are things that help me on that path.
Okay, thanks.
I think that one of the ways that having this belief helps me to interact with problems with other individuals or challenges in work or whatever types of conflicts that come up in my life is to really feel secure, to concentrate on eliminating whatever fears and doubts are sort of naturally come up for me with that conflict, and to really have faith that it's going to turn out for the best, that I'm going to be safe in whatever context that might be. That gives me the courage or the strength to be aggressively good in the way I approach it, as opposed to passively accepting or really not doing anything about it, just assuming that everything's going to work out and not taking action or making decisions or making choices. That having that type of security means that you can actually energize the love or the positive response to that situation that really is most necessary in resolving it.
It sounds like sort of the opposite, perhaps, of martial arts. I mean, there you're poised and trained and ready to kind of rebuff an attack. What you're saying, I think, is that you can be poised and ready to love.
Right.
In the midst of a certain despair or whatever.
I mean, it's certainly not something that I think I have mastered.
Sure.
But it's reassuring to know when you fall off track or you become uncentered to have a strong sense of how you've gotten off track.
Good. Do you have any thoughts on that?
James, our Bhagavad Gita, which is our preliminary scripture, means the song of God, explains that the nature of this world is happiness and distress. They come and go like winter and summer seasons. And that we shouldn't spend our lives' energy trying to compensate for the periods of distress and becoming overly attached to the periods of happiness, which again will also disappear. But we should try to focus our real life's goal on understanding how can I deal with the situation in a way that will help me understand my spiritual nature and develop my love for God.
Good. Well, I'll tell you what, we're going to take a brief pause here, and we'll be back in just about 60 seconds to take some questions from the audience.
The American Pilgrims. In the 1600s, these determined men and women, so few in number, conquered the hostile wilderness and began a new life of freedom and democracy for themselves and all who followed. The great American wild turkey was abundant in those days and was not only one of the pilgrims' main food sources, but was served at their first Thanksgiving feast. The neighboring Indians were invited to share this holiday with the pilgrims and to commemorate their harvest, and the Feast of Thanksgiving became one of our country's most cherished traditions. No wonder Benjamin Franklin proposed the wild turkey be our country's symbol. However, land clearing in the 1800s made this powerful bird almost extinct. But the wild turkey has made a comeback over the past several years thanks to careful wildlife management, a tribute to American conservation efforts. You can help keep the legendary American wild turkey alive. Write Wild Turkey, Box 530, Edgefield, South Carolina.
Thank you for rejoining Spiritual Spectrum. In this portion of the show, we're going to go to the audience, and we're going to ask one of the members to offer a question to our distinguished panel and see how well they can handle that. So let's go to the question now.
How can you sense God's presence in your life, and how do you feel it's manifested to others?
So if I understand that correctly, she's asking, how can you sense the presence of God, and how can you actually kind of transport the experience so that others get it too?
Well, just a recent experience that I've had was being in conflict with another individual, a friend who means a lot to me, and having a sense of frustration with communication and just the normal kind of conflicts you have with people. and feeling a sense, a natural sense of anger or animosity building up, and then trying to focus on letting my spiritual nature or the nature of God participate in that relationship at that time, and really having a sense that those feelings of negativity or of animosity really were replaced with higher feelings of understanding and of concern for the other person. And I have a strong feeling that that's God participating in my life, that it's not my natural response, that it's a higher response, and that at a point of conflict, I can choose to let God into my life, to let God replace what is my lower nature with a higher nature and a higher response. It certainly works in relationships. That's the way I see most clearly. Another way is that I will observe in other people God's love for me as an individual or for each other. Or when I'm having a particular problem in my life and I confide in my friends and am open to receiving truth information that I need, and having someone say just exactly the right thing at the right time, what I needed to hear to overcome anxiety or doubt or fear or feelings of inadequacy.
It seems like a real critical part of this is your own willingness to kind of have this more human or lower nature transcended or some kind of an override by the higher part of you, the more loving part.
Exactly. I mean, it definitely has to be my choice. I have to allow God's will in my life. I have to consciously choose it.
So it can't participate if you're in a jam and you're not kind of that invitation.
Right.
Can I respond to
Please.
This? James, we understand that actually God is a person. There's actually personality there. And that just as in this world we're all experiencing and or seeking to experience satisfaction in our relationships with our parents or with our children, with our friends, with our bosses, there's different types of what in Sanskrit is called rasa, or relationships, and that in this world the different types of pleasures we get out of relationships with our friends and with our loved ones is actually a reflection, it's kind of a earthly dimensional replication of the same relationships that we can experience in a very personal relationship with the Supreme Person. This is why we call God Krishna. It's a Sanskrit name that means the all-attractive person. As all of us are individual persons, we have certain attractive qualities that we can share and feel attracted to in each of our different relationships, and that as we advance in our spiritual progress in this lifetime, we gradually begin to experience that God actually is a person, and we have a relationship with Him and can experience loving emotions with Him in the same way that we do in this world, but to a much more satisfying degree. And we follow a particular type of process within our yoga practice of chanting or meditating on the names of God, understanding that He incarnates in different ways in different ages. And in this particular time, by focusing and meditating on God's names, we become purified and can experience this relationship. The same thing is explained in the Old Testament. King David explained, once you glorify the name of God from morning until night, on cymbals and on harps, just like sometimes people think that this is very bizarre activity, you Hare Krishnas are clanging these cymbals like that, glorifying God's names, but actually it's spoken also in the Old Testament. And of course Jesus said that one who calls upon my name will be saved, and he also explained our Father who art in heaven in the Lord's Prayer, hallowed be thy name. Buddha also explained that one who calls upon my name, I will come and will take him to nirvana. So that focus on glorifying God's name is there. So this is the particular process that we try to follow for experiencing this relationship.
I'm going to conjecture that I suggest a little bit of difference here, perhaps, because I see Crystalline nodding her head, and I don't see you nodding your head, Beth. How does this sense of personal God work for you as a theosophist?
For me as a theosophist, this personal God has, at some points along my path, seemed to be very real and very close, very experienceable. At other times on my path, she hasn't seemed to be personal. I would say the particular point I am right now on my path, I am what you would call an impersonalist.
Uh-huh.
I don't think of God as a person. I do think that there's something more. I do think that there's ultimate meaning. I do think that if I try to align myself with goodness and meaningfulness, then I'm able to do some of the things you're talking about, or to let those things happen through me, whatever. Sometimes I use the language of God, and sometimes I don't. Right now I don't use it very much, but I have a suspicion that one of the experiences of God, of the presence of God, is the experience of the absence of God, because there's a great emptiness when you're experiencing the apparent absence of God. I'm reminded of St. Augustine in the Christian tradition saying, "Our hearts are restless till they rest in thee." And I think people like me who are in impersonalist stages tend to feel rather restless. Huh. Whether that means that ultimately I'm going to know God in a personal way again, I don't know. So
that's
I had to be a little bit quiet there.
Yeah, that's wonderful. I think for me that the same paradox is present, and that at some point the notion of God, or whatever the concept of God is endeavoring to express, mm-hmm. remains quite formless, quite abstract, very present, but not particularly personified. Mm-hmm. And then every once in a while, bang, it'll just show up in a really personified yeah. sense, either through perhaps another individual that I know, mm-hmm. you know, humanly, or through some kind of a more divine manifestation in terms of an inspiration or something like that. And I guess the Godhead gets to be whatever it wants.
Just an interesting philosophical point, because the Vedas discuss both the impersonal and the personal features mm-hmm. of God, and explain that ultimately, because God is the source of everything, both personal and impersonal energies have to be contained within that supreme being, as well mm-hmm. as feminine and masculine, mm-hmm. all these different qualities and characteristics. But the Vedas present the point that, well, if God is the absolute truth and the source of everything, that whatever we experience in this world must also be coming from God. Mm-hmm. Nothing that we experience here can be outside of God or God's energies. So that if we experience relationships here, if we experience personality, we experience form, sometimes we think, and certain philosophers develop the idea that because relationships here are painful, spiritual life must mean no relationships, because there can't be pain in spiritual life, or because form here is temporary, there can't be form within the spiritual realm. But the Vedas point out that actually everything here must be there also within the spiritual realm, but it's different quality. So the personality is not subject to the imperfections that we experience here, but it's in its original pure form, pure nature. And then what we're experiencing, and we're having some difficulties in terms of deriving complete satisfaction from, is because it's not in its
complete
entirety. It's kind of like a two-dimensional copy. It's like if you may see a bowl of fruit on the table, very scrumptious looking apple and banana and orange, but if it's a plastic replica, even though it looks very, very nice, and we may be salivating over thinking, what a nice, beautiful piece of fruit, let me taste it, because it's not the original, it's kind of a copy, it looks like it's going to do what it's supposed to do, but it can't, it's not within its nature.
The thought that comes up for me is, I think a lot of times in this plane we tend to eat the menu rather than ordering from it. But let's go to our audience again and see if they have any more stimulating thoughts. Do we have another question?
Please share with us that which you most believe will foster the unification of the family of man.
Thank you. Certainly important. Each of you, speaking from your own tradition and from your own personal experience on the planet, what do you think will most foster our unification as a species?
I think that if we could not be tolerant, but rather be celebrating of our diversities, that would be wonderful. And that is in fact the first of the three objects of the Theosophical Society, is to promote the brotherhood of man. All kinds of people, any sexes, any races, any persuasions, promote the brotherhood. And certainly when I look at my own brother and sisters, there's great diversity there. And usually I try to do a little better than just tolerate my brother and sisters. And I think that when we can celebrate the fact that we are so different and make good come out of that, instead of moan about the differences that sometimes could lead to conflict, that could help.
Good, thanks.
I would agree very much with what Bev said. One of the things that the Urantia book says is that unity is desirable. Unity is the goal, not uniformity. And that diversity is a desired state. And that, you know, truth being so diverse and so all-encompassing, we really need a lot of different facets in the way people think, the way people act, personalities, beliefs, ideals, to really get the full picture. And that we don't need to agree with each other to love each other. You know, we don't need to agree on everything, on all points. That when we see the spirit unity, you know, the family of man concept, that we can overcome conflicts very easily. And I think that a family framework to conceptualize that is really good, because I know with my own brother, you know, we'll disagree on a lot of things, or we certainly have very different personalities and different manifestations in our lives, but we really love each other a lot, and there's never any conflict that could cause a rift between us. You know, you have that kind of connection, and I think that's what we need on a universal sense.
Good. Anurama?
James, I think it, this is a very important question, a very deep one, but that a lot of the focus to this type of a question has to be brought up in a very practical sense. And I would kind of expand upon this well-intentioned principle that how can we have happiness and peace amongst the family of man? I would advocate that we have to expand our conceptions of what that family includes, that not only do we have to be concerned with the human species, but also there's other species in this world that have a right to live and a right to procreate and to live happily in this planet. And that as long as we, as one and only one species on this planet, are thinking that everything here is meant for our enjoyment or our exploitation. For example, we advocate very strongly the principle of vegetarianism. Isaac Bashevis Singer, the Nobel Prize winner, he stated, how is it that we can go on asking for mercy from God if we don't have mercy for other creatures? And that we, as a species, have to understand that if we live in a violent way towards nature around us, towards other living entities, by eating animals, as an example, and by violating the environment around us, that within the context of karma and the fact that everything is God's energy, it's His creation, we don't have a right to violate that selfishly. We have a right to take our quota in terms of foodstuffs and what we need to live comfortably, but we can't exploit other living entities. And if we continue doing that in the name of peace amongst mankind while creating violence against other species, we'll never be able to live peacefully.
An interesting thought comes up for me. I read in one book that was some material that was reported to be channeled by a person who was quite sensitive to information coming from beyond this realm, that the spirit of cattle had asked to be removed from the planet because of the sort of violence that they tend to sustain here at the hand of man, which I don't know how you would verify that or not, but it certainly does bring up an interesting thought when you look at how they're raised for slaughter and the way they're treated from basically even sometimes before conception to that end.
As in the Bible it stated, as you sow, so shall ye reap. Ideas there. If we live in a violent way, then we'll be forced to live in a violent society. If we minimize those things, then the violence amongst ourselves will also minimize.
I guess what I might object to in terms of that is there's a very mechanistic attitude. It's almost like the cellular material and the DNA that comes forth as cattle becomes treated as a cattle-making machine. And we tend to objectify a lot of these things perhaps further than is appropriate for us. I'm going to once again take a moment here to pause. I'd like to tell our viewing audience that during this pause they might find it helpful to get a pencil and a piece of paper, because when we come back later we'll have a slide that will give the address and the phone number for Spiritual Spectrum, and you can pick up on that at that time and write us with your questions or comments. Now we're going to pause for a brief message.
The AFS International Student Exchange. It's a lot more than just a trip abroad.
AFS is a chance of a lifetime, really, because it's a chance to live with a family and see the culture, you know, through daily life instead of as a tourist.
You know, AFS experience, it helps you to interact with people of different cultures and races, helps you to understand other people more, to really accept, acknowledge, and appreciate other people's cultures, their policies, you know, their whole way of life.
AFS is a great opportunity to learn about another culture, but also more about yourself.
If you've got a sense of adventure, go for it. It's the best thing.
I think AFS is one of the most challenging and also difficult, but at the same time, exciting and rewarding experiences of one's life.
If you're a high school student who wants to live in another culture, learn a new language, even win a college scholarship, call AFS.
Welcome back to Spiritual Spectrum. Once again, we're going to go to the audience and see if they have any other questions that can stump our stars.
How come God put us here?
Okay. Very simple, direct, straight to the point. How come God put us here?
I'll take a jump at that one.
Please.
In the Isha Upanishad, another ancient Vedic literature explains that God is the self-sufficient philosopher who has been fulfilling everyone's desires since time immemorial. So the understanding is that we all are individual, eternal, spiritual beings, spiritual persons, and then we have a relationship with the Supreme Person. And he, being the supreme controller, is giving us facility to satisfy our different desires. By nature, we are eternal residents of the spiritual world, the kingdom of God, and we have loving relationships with him and engage in different types of spiritual activities and join that loving exchange with him. But we also have minute independence, and we can utilize that independence to choose either to serve God, or we can utilize our independence to try to live separately from God. And if we choose to do that, as each and every one of us has done to be in this material realm, then he provides an opportunity for us to come into this material world to try ultimately to be satisfied separate from him. And this is where so many different concepts of terms of karma and why there's problems in this world and the different learning experiences that we've been talking about, where they come into play. Because ultimately this world has got two purposes, one of which is to help us understand that no matter how hard I try, like the fish out of water, something ain't going right, no matter how hard I try. And number two, that the reason that is because I meant to experience a loving relationship with God, and that's where my real satisfaction comes, just like a man enjoys a love relationship with his wife or with his children, etc. And that he puts us here to teach us these lessons. And that when we learn these lessons, if we understand them even in this lifetime, then we can be very happy in the midst of whatever difficulties we're experiencing or shortcomings of ourselves or the world around us. And if we don't understand these things, it's kind of a futile struggle against time, which is ultimately going to destroy all of our plans anyway. So we should take advantage of the great wisdom of the great religious teachers of the past, whatever tradition they may be. They all have the same basic message, which is lay none up your treasures where moth and dust corrupt, but instead we should seek the kingdom of God. And that's why puts us here, so we'll learn that and we can attain it in this life.
Great. That's a pretty thorough answer. I don't know if there's anything that either of you would want to add to that or not. Is there more?
Well, you might want to subtract from it.
Well, that's fine too. That's fine too. Why does God put us here?
Well, I wanted to add a step further that we are here as evolutionary beings, that we're moving toward perfection as individuals. But we're also a key to the expansion of God itself, in that if God dwells within each of us, that God is also experiencing our growth from imperfection towards perfection, that as an absolute perfected being who's been perfect since all creation, that would be a unique experience to evolve. And so we are each individually ultimately important to the experience of growth, that God has a better understanding of us as creatures developing by experiencing our growth.
Any more, Beth?
Well, being in an impersonalist stage, I would probably rephrase the question.
Okay.
From
sure.
Why did God put us here to why am I here?
Uh-huh.
And then I'd probably answer it the same way you just did. I might not use exactly the word of God. I might say that I am here to become God in some sense. It sounds a bit heretical in some traditions, but I am here as an imperfect being. And I think that one of the things that makes us rail against death is that we do all this learning and all this growing, and then we stop. And I have the sense that we do all this learning and all this growing, and then we just do some more learning and growing and learning and growing, this evolving you're talking about. If there could ever be an end to it, I imagine that that end would be to become one who has learned and done all the growing there is, and that, if there is a God, would be to be God, I guess. So perhaps somewhat different from yours. I don't know your tradition so well to know whether you retain a distinction between God and
one of the teachings of the Urantia book is that we are growing with a purpose. I mean, that we're evolving mm-hmm. towards an individual and unique purpose for each individual. That purpose is different, but that it also describes the cosmology of the universe as one that is expanding, mm-hmm. and that as we grow and towards perfection, we later have a purpose in continuing that expansion, that creation of the universe, that we each do eventually become administrators or creators in some sense of the word. I mean, it goes into a lot more detail than I have time to at this point, but that there's a definite purpose and that our learning is definitely an aid to us in the way we present to other generations when we're in charge, mm-hmm. so to speak.
Okay. I'd like to trace back to something I think I heard you said, Anurupa. Is it the case that you said that we're here in this physical embodiment because we chose to see what it would be like to satisfy ourselves separate from God?
Yes, in other words, God being the supreme person is also the supreme enjoyer, and that the difference between our idea and the impersonalist idea being that we are qualitatively the same as God, but quantitatively very different. We have the same, although we're presently embodied in this material world and we don't act necessarily as spiritual beings, that's our natural, again, constitutional position, qualitatively the same as God, but we're very, very small. But because He is the supreme person and has supreme independence, we also have minute independence. And we sometimes may misuse that independence and want to be the center, which is His position, and not so much want to be cooperative enjoyers, but become the central enjoyer. And I think this isn't such a radical idea. When we look at the world around us, we can see this is the root, one of the root causes of so much conflict. People are thinking, I want my maybe religion to be in the center and to be the dominant position, or I'd like my nation to be in the center, be the dominant position. I'd like my neighborhood to be in the center, be the dominant position. I'd like my race to be like that. Whatever we're identifying with, there's this tendency to want everything kind of me-centered, that this is the root cause of what we call material consciousness, that spiritual realization and this higher purpose we're all talking about is understanding that my function is to put God in the center. And if God is in the center, then there's unity. If you have a center which is based on your body and your race and whatever ideas you have, I have a center based on my body, my race, my nation, you have your center. Just like if you have a pond, if you throw a stone in one particular place, I throw a stone in one particular place, Bev throws a stone in a particular place, there's going to be so many ripples coming from the different centers and they're going to clash. But if we have the same center, if we each drop one stone, maybe of different sizes and weights, at the same central point, then even though there's still individuality in terms of we're each putting our own contribution, our own stone, the ripples will be in harmony. So if we understand that God, or as we call Him, Krishna, is in the center as the supreme enjoyer, the supreme beloved, the supreme friend, and all of our actions are dedicated towards satisfying Him, then there's no conflict between our different activities. You're trying to satisfy God, I'm trying to satisfy God, and I appreciate what you're doing, and I want to help you because it's the same thing that I want to do. And if you're better at it than I am, I don't become envious, or I don't try to take away your position, because I realize that, oh, this is so wonderful, you're such a wonderful servant of God, let me help you. Now let me try to push you down, as we often do in this materialistic realm. Someone gets a little too good at their particular thing, and we try to, you know, push them down and we come up. And that's a great difference between actual spiritual understanding and activity and material activity.
Is it as a result of misusing our minute independence that the physical world has arisen?
Yes, in the sense that God, He manifests this realm for us in the same way the example is given. Sometimes a child has seen the mother in the kitchen doing so many things with the stove and this and that, and they want to take the position of the mother, but they're not necessarily qualified. So the mother says, well, here's a couple little pots and pans for you, and here's a little play stove, and I'll go over there and play for a little while. Get out of my hair. See, because a child doesn't necessarily want to help make dinner the way that that would be useful. So it's a little bit of a kind of an activity off the side that not make any problems for anybody. We don't accept this principle that God is a vindictive type of personality where if we violate His laws or rebel against Him, that He simply says, okay, you know, you're out of the garden or you're out of the kingdom and burn forever, or that in this realm you only get one chance to understand Him. But He's the unlimitedly loving Father. Okay. So He gives us unlimited chances in this realm.
Good. Well, I'll tell you what. We've got one more question to go. Let's take that and see where it leads us, all right?
Do you feel that the current trend of evangelism, and by this I'm speaking to TV evangelists, do you believe this current trend is being accepted because its focus is on prosperity and is therefore more acceptable to our capitalist economy?
That's interesting. Certainly not an otherworldly kind of question. That's going to bring us right down to the here and now things. TV evangelism. Very money-centered in one sense. You think that's the roots of its popularity?
I think there's a tremendous need, a tremendously strong need in our civilization for spiritual focus. And I think that there's been a lot of ambivalence. I think we're sort of moving out of a very material, secular, industrial age. And there are generations of people who are really feeling a lack of a spiritual centeredness or spiritual focus in their life. And I think that that's probably why we see this resurgence of attention to evangelism. I'm not sure if the if all of the evangelists fall into a really materialistic category. I certainly think that there are a lot of ministers, public ministers, who are probably very sincerely interested in the spiritual growth of our society, of our planet. But it does seem like there is a tremendous focus on materialism. And when I see that, it does tend to make me apprehensive, make me question the spiritual motive behind the ministry.
Bev, any thoughts?
Well, earlier tonight I said that the universe is very good and it's all perfect. And when you think about some of the scandals associated with TV evangelism lately, you say, you mean that's perfect and that's good too? And I began thinking of that as you talked, and I thought, yes, it makes me uncomfortable too. And yet, if indeed it is all good, there probably is even something good in that which some of us are joining in not feeling too good about. For example, suppose some of the response to some of the TV evangelism is, oh, you mean if I pray like that, then I'll get what I want, and then I'll be happy? And I think there are people who are seeking happiness through getting what they want, a car, a home, better relationships, whatever. And suppose they do pray, and suppose they do get the home, the relationship, whatever. I suspect that what they'll find when they get what it was they were after is that it's not enough, that it's somehow they're still hungry. There's a hunger for something more, something other. I think maybe you can't know that hunger for something more until perhaps you've satisfied some of these more materialistic, we were saying, needs. And so maybe it's all very perfect. You know, we can call some people to a way that they can get what they think they want, and maybe they'll discover that it isn't enough, and maybe that's movement along the path. So it all turns out okay anyway, at least on that realm level.
I think that anything that directs people towards a personal relationship with God is a positive thing. And I have faith in people that their spiritual natures will triumph eventually.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're about to run out of time here. I'd like to make this opportunity available for the folks out there to get the address and the phone number for Spiritual Spectrum. So we'll have a slide of that coming up on the screen here briefly. In fact, there it is. Spiritual Spectrum, 2351 Ogden Street, Denver, Colorado, 80205. Area code 303-861-1186. So if you have any questions or comments, we'd certainly enjoy hearing from you. I'd like to thank everyone for their participation tonight. Anudama. And Bev and Crystalline. It's been a very rewarding experience for me, and I hope that it's been a rewarding experience for you too, our viewers. So I'd like to invite you to tune in once again when Spiritual Spectrum explores the newly emerging trends in the American religious scene. Thank you.